Hello and welcome to Common Ground, an inside look at Suffolk County. I'm your host, Sheriff Steve Tompkins. Now today we've got two of the candidates for the Lieutenant Governor's position here in the Commonwealth. And first up at the plate is Leland Cheung, a Cambridge City Councilor, an extraordinary young man, highly gifted, incredibly intelligent, and he's here today to tell us why you should consider giving him your vote to be the next Lieutenant Governor of this great state. Sir, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
Really appreciate it. So listen, number one, let's, before we get into the issues, talk to us about the actual process of running across, traversing the Commonwealth to run for office. What's that like? What have you learned?
A lot of driving. But before I even began running for Lieutenant Governor, I actually served on the state's Economic Development Board. I was appointed there by Governor Patrick 3 years ago after writing an article in the Globe that was criticizing a policy that I thought was pitting cities against each other instead of encouraging us to work together. So I've actually already had the opportunity to travel throughout the Commonwealth from, you know, Otis to the Cape to Western Mass to Springfield to Holyoke. So it's like that times 10.
And what's it like when you actually get to these places and talk to the folks? I'm sure the folks out west have a little different view of what's going on than the folks down in the South Coast.
What I've found is actually that everywhere you go in the Commonwealth, there are these pockets of talent, of expertise, of skill sets. Every town has its own unique charm. Every city has its own unique characteristics, which is part of the great thing about living in Massachusetts. You can drive half an hour and be in some place that's completely picturesque. But the same reason I ran for the Cambridge City Council 5 years ago in 2009, which was namely that we weren't talking about how we make sure that we're not just creating jobs for the people with PhDs from MIT, but everyone in our community, whether you have a GED or a two-year degree. It's the same problem, same challenge and opportunity we face as a Commonwealth as a whole. And I think that that's the opportunity to serve on the governor's, on the board of the, our state's Economic Development Agency, at the will and pleasure of the governor, really drove that home for me. And it's even, I've even become more apparent as I've been running for Lieutenant Governor, because I've been able to visit even more places and realize that there are so many people out there that with just a little bit of help to get their skills up to date could get on themselves on a path for a career, not just a job.
So let's jump into the issues and let's start with education. That's the burning issue right now of the day. Where do you stand on education and where do you stand particularly on, let's start with the public schools and then we'll switch over to the charters.
I'm pro-education.
Well, there it is, folks.
You can, I think you can tell from my from my background that, you know, it wasn't always fun growing up with a tiger mother and a dragon dad, but they always pushed me to recognize the importance of education and of investing in your own education. And I think that as a Commonwealth, I think we need to invest in the education of each other. I think that's the only way forward. I think education is the key to success for the Commonwealth going forward.
We are
never going to be a state that competes based on having low-skilled labor that big companies can come in and exploit, paying rock-bottom wages and having pushing them onto the public healthcare system. We're going to be a state that competes based on having a highly skilled labor pool with the best productivity, with the best people, the best minds, and as much as we can invest in education to increase the skills and potential of those people, the better off we're all going to do.
So talk to me about the public school system in particular, because depending upon where you live in the state, your public schools are better or not as good. How do you get some parity as Lieutenant Governor and working with whomever the governor may be, he or she, and the legislators to get some parity across the board for all of our public schools?
Yeah, I mean, you don't even have to look across the state. I mean, even within Cambridge, where I've been a city councilor, we have schools that are consistently doing well and schools that are consistently underperforming. A lot of that has to do with you know, the socioeconomic background of the students that come from there. But I don't think that's, I do not accept that as an excuse or as a reason for why kids should not do well. I think that we have, we've seen other models in other states and other schools. We've seen it done. We know the basics of what kids need to learn. And if, you know, if we've done it before, if kids aren't getting a hot breakfast at home, we provide it to them in school. If kids aren't getting read to early education, we've modeled programs in Cambridge with early ed where we're reading to kids. There is absolutely no excuse, no matter what zip code you're born into, no matter what city you live in, no matter what town you come from, that you shouldn't graduate if you're here in Massachusetts with a top-notch education prepared for whatever you want to do in life.
And what do you stand on charter schools?
I have three issues with charter schools, and I can tell you what those are. First of all, I think that charter schools, the promise of charter schools, and I have an 8-month-old daughter at home, and so I get what parents feel when they want to have a choice to try and make sure that their kid gets to go to the best school that they possibly can get themselves into.
Right.
But charter schools were sold to us, and they said, oh, they're going to be the innovation laboratories. We're going to try different things out. We're going to bring those back into the public school. Well, that hasn't happened. Mm-hmm. There's been rhetoric on both sides, but the reality is that we have not taken the innovation back into our public schools, and so I think that the premise has proven false. The second thing is the funding model. I've seen it in Cambridge, and I think you only really get to experience this as a city councilor. Charter schools are essentially taking money away from our public schools. Mm-hmm. At the same time that we're being told that the charter schools are going to help improve the public schools, we're taking money away from them, thus decreasing their ability to compete and to educate students. I think that's another issue that we need to address. The third thing is, what does this all lead to? Does this all lead to we have privatized education where every single school is you know, just run by a different organization or a nonprofit or a corporation or some kind of entity, and we have just competition between them and parents get to pick based on what the competition is? Well, let me tell you where that ends up. So, you know, if I have an Android, I don't know if you have an iPhone on Android, but, you know, so there's the free market, there's competition. But in the free market, there's winners and losers. So if Android goes out of business or Apple goes out of business, I got to switch phones. I refuse to accept that there should be, in a private model where there's winners and losers, that is the model we want to apply to education. I refuse to believe that there should be winners and losers. Every single child, we have the capacity, we know how to do it, we've seen schools do it. Every single child should be graduating with whatever they need to go wherever they want to in life.
But so in this office of Lieutenant Governor, how do you effectuate that change? I understand what you're saying about every child should have the ability to do this, and that we have seen schools that have effectuated that and have gotten it done.
Yeah.
How do you get that across the board?
Yeah. So the main way that you get that across the board, I think the governor has a lot on their plate. They've got to worry about everything from, you know, potholes on the turnpike to running the agencies. Mm-hmm. The lieutenant governor has a unique ability to focus. Mm-hmm. I've been entrepreneurial my entire career, so the idea of having, you know, a staff, a platform, the ability to go out at the grassroots level and build support for an idea is something that really is the reason why I'm running for lieutenant governor. That's what appeals to me. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to go out and make sure that everyone in the Commonwealth knows that when it comes to voting time, to support their legislators, their senators, their state reps in supporting education. And I'll give you one example. So I got my MBA from MIT Sloan. Every few years, I send a bunch of people out to visit Warren Buffett. And a few years before I was at the school there, they came back with a story. They asked Warren. I was told this story, and it stayed with me till this day. They asked him, if you could make one investment, what would it be? You know, go back in time. Would you put all your money into Apple? Would you put all your money into like these mortgage-backed securities that wreck the economy but get it out sooner? You know, what would you do?
Right.
His answer was that he would make a deal with the U.S. government, and he would say, you educate kids to the point where you're done. You know, whether that's high school, community college, state school, whatever. I'll take them from there. I'll educate them to their full potential, but I get the difference in taxes that they will pay for the rest of their lives. Mm-hmm. That's the message we need to continue to hammer out. I think the lieutenant governor has the ability to make sure that everyone understands. When your neighbor paints and improves their house, your home value goes up. Mm-hmm. It's the same thing with the Commonwealth. If we're willing to invest in each other and invest in each other's kids, we're all going to benefit.
Talk to me about business. Two-part question. How would you attract more businesses to the Commonwealth? First part. Second part of the question, what do you do? How would you inspire or convince businesses that are here to remain here?
Yeah.
So let's start with the first. How do you get new businesses here?
So like I said, I think we're never going to be a state that competes based on having low-skilled labor that companies come in and exploit. We're never going to be a state that competes based on having, you know, these tax breaks to big companies to get them to move here, and then as soon as the tax break's done, they're packing up and leaving.
So you're not in favor of giving companies tax breaks to come or to stay?
No. I think what I'm in favor of, and how I think we're going to compete, is we're going to compete based on having the most educated workforce, the highest productivity, the best labor pool you can possibly find anywhere. That's how we're going to get more companies to move here. And I think we also don't do a good enough job promoting what we have. Lowell has one of three of plastics engineering institutes in the entire world. Mm-hmm. They've spun out tons of companies. If you want to build something out of plastic, Lowell is where you should be heading to. But so often when I talk to entrepreneurs and they think about developing their next widget and getting to market, they're talking about outsourcing to China or India or where in the world, not realizing they can drive an hour, be at the manufacturer, and by the way, probably keep your IP. Mm-hmm. I think that's how we keep companies coming here, is by continuing to promote the expertise that we already have, and having served on the state's economic development board, having running for lieutenant governor, and having visited a lot of these places, I know that we have a ton of expertise. I think promoting that, and I think also in educating and giving opportunities for our workforce to get to the next level. And you want to?
No. Go ahead.
The reason I'm running for lieutenant governor, I really feel like we're at a tipping point, where we can either double down on the investments that Governor Patrick has made in infrastructure, education, and job creation, or we're going to go backwards with Baker. Mm-hmm. And we're at a tipping point because we've already seen jobs go mm-hmm. overseas. Mm-hmm. But the people that used to work at those plants that have closed, their skill, there's a difference between their skill and where the very top. The highest performers, the highest productivity in the world is still pretty small. And if we just invest a little bit in workforce development, invest a little bit in education, we can get them there. Mm-hmm. And that'll bring companies here.
So why don't we do
that? But if we don't do that, mm-hmm. that gap is only going to widen.
But I'm curious, why don't we do that? Because what you're saying sounds rather simplistic and straightforward, but it doesn't get done.
Yep.
Why not?
I believe that we need a lieutenant governor, like I said. So I was there when the governor was talking about the transportation bond bill.
Right.
You know, he recently introduced a jobs bill that for some reason no one's talking about, which I think would make us, one of the most competitive states in the nation.
Right.
But no one's talking about it. And because it requires a little bit of self-sacrifice, and it goes back to the analogy I gave before. You know, it requires just a little bit of self-sacrifice collectively to invest in each other, and that'll make us all better off. Like I said, if your neighbor improves their house, your home value goes up. Yeah. And it's the same thing. If we invest in the economy of Massachusetts, if we invest in each other, if we invest in the fundamentals of what will bring companies back here, which is education, which is the infrastructure that connects our state together, which is the engines of job creation. If we invest in that, then there's going to be more companies coming here, there's going to be more jobs, everyone's going to benefit.
So here's the frustrating thing.
Yeah.
So if, very small word, mm-hmm. two letters, with such a large resonance, frankly. If you looked at, just say, the interstate highway system, Medicaid, Medicare, if we tried to introduce that now in this climate, in this economic climate, I don't know that these things would ever get passed.
Yeah.
You see, and when you talk about if we did what you're saying that we should do, mm-hmm. my question is, why don't legislators see that? Why don't they?
Yeah.
And is it because they're not getting enough of a kick in the backside from their constituencies to make this happen?
Yeah, I think I remember when the governor introduced the transportation bond bill, that I was at the Mass Municipal Association conference, and I was meeting with all the mayors. And it was like 2 months afterwards, after he introduced it. Well, the lieutenant governor could have been out there 2 months or 4 months previously, building that grassroots support mm-hmm. with all the city councilors, with the selectmen, with the town meeting members, with the mayors, mm-hmm. with the city managers, and helping them understand, answering their questions as to why this was going to help improve their town and improve their lot in life and mm-hmm. help their residents. Mm-hmm. The lieutenant governor has the opportunity to do that because, frankly, they don't have all the responsibilities that the governor has to worry mm-hmm. about on a day-to-day basis. And I think the lieutenant governor should be the person out there selling this vision, building the grassroots support, promoting the ideas, answering the questions before these things are even announced to the floor mm-hmm. to the House and Senate. And I think that's why, and then that will give the legislators, the senators, the state reps, the support that they need mm-hmm. to be confident that their mm-hmm. people understand the issues, understand how it's going to benefit them, and want them to vote yes.
So the lieutenant governor does a better job at setting the table.
Yep.
So that when the meal is placed on the table, it's easily digested, or a little easily digested. I mean, if you get the analogy here.
Yeah.
But in a way in which we actually get some things done. I agree with you on the infrastructure.
Yeah.
I find it extraordinarily perplexing, not only in this state, but across the nation. When you talk about our roads and our bridges and so on and so forth, our schools and others, that we just don't seem to want to put our arms around this and get these things taken care of.
Yeah.
You know, it's just so frustrating.
Answer is yes.
Yeah. I like that. healthcare.
Yeah.
One of another big burning issues, the cost that's required to basically take care of our citizens in a very holistic, healthy way. Yeah. As Lieutenant Governor, well, how do you champion that cause to get healthcare to all of our citizens?
So imagine if, so we've led the nation before. I think we can lead the nation again. Mm-hmm. And I know that this isn't popular with insurance companies, but imagine if, so what is insurance? Insurance is the aggregation of a pool of people to aggregate risk. Because if we're in that pool, I don't know if you're gonna get sick, I don't know if I'm gonna get sick, but I know that over a pool, over the population, somebody is gonna get sick.
Right.
And what's the largest pool possible to amortize that risk over? Everybody,
mm-hmm.
right? And so I think that's what we need to hammer home. And there's always efficiencies you can be wrung out. There's always trying to do things more cost effectively. But the fundamental reality is there. And what I learned in business school in the class on insurance was that depending on where you market, you know, if you market in Forbes magazine versus the National Enquirer, mm-hmm. you get a different pool of people applying to your insurance. Mm-hmm. And so there might be rules that you have to accept everybody. But based on where you market, you get a different pool of people.
Mm-hmm.
And so then the government winds up getting the people who didn't get into any of the other insurances and winds up getting the most risky pool. And then the other side, Republicans, go and point and say, well, that's why, you know, why are you so much more expensive?
Mm-hmm.
We were set up to fail from the very beginning. So I think that insurance, I think that there's a lot we can do in healthcare. I think that all the healthcare innovation is coming out of the state. I think that there's a lot of knowledge that we can bring to the table, and we can lead the nation again in terms of reducing costs. That's already been, the table for that has already been set by Walsh, who recently is stepping down, as you know, mm-hmm. From the legislature. But I think the table has been set, and there's a lot that we can do to make healthcare more cost effective for employers and employees, and that we need to lead the nation again on that. So
there's been a big discussion about community health centers and the utilization of community health centers as a way to decrease the cost when folks go to the emergency room and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on the higher usage of community health centers?
Yeah. So I mean, we have some in Cambridge. We've been in a lot of discussions recently with the Cambridge Health Alliance. I think the issues frankly are that under the new rules, whereas they used to be the safety net and helping the people that didn't get, they are now being under the new paradigm, they're having to compete mm-hmm. on a level playing field. And that alone has increased their costs at the same time that our reimbursement rates have gone down. And I think that's part of the problem. But we absolutely need community health centers, but we also need to give people, I think we have if you ever watched the Bionic Man, we have the technology,
mm-hmm.
we have the skill, we have the knowledge. What we need is the will to make sure that every single person is taken care of. And it's fundamentally a values decision. We know that we value people even when they're sick. That we value people even when they have a disease. And I think that it requires collective self-sacrifice, but I think that's a choice that we've made about who we are as a people and who we are as individuals. So,
you know what, I want to backtrack. I want to go back to education for a second. And I want to ask you about, along with community health centers, I'm curious as to where you stand on community colleges
mm-hmm.
as an entry point to colleges,
yep.
to four-year schools, and using community colleges as that kind of training center to teach folks how to move up the ladder.
Yeah.
Where do you come down on community colleges? And as an aside, vocational education.
Absolutely. So So in my mind, we're at a tipping point.
Yes.
It's all hands on deck. And so that means that, you know, we should bring the community colleges into our high schools to do voc ed mm-hmm. trainings. We should have our employers, it used to be that like companies like GE would train their employees with the next set of skills to modernize them. We need to have our employers helping out with job training.
Right.
And instead of just complaining that we can't build the MBTA cars in Massachusetts because we can't find welders. Well, how about they help us train the welders?
Right.
You know what? And how about we help them help work with the unions to help them increase their programs,
right?
We need to have the community colleges come into our high schools and instead of going to the community college to do your remedial classes.
Right, exactly.
You know, when you're racking up debt, why don't we bring them into our high schools and have the classes taught there? So that they can get caught up,
right.
and so they can be at the same level before they even get to community college and start racking up that debt.
Right.
Okay. And so up and down the road. And then why don't we have our we have one of the greatest public university systems in the country? Why don't we form more partnerships? We've already formed partnerships with them in Cambridge to bring them into our schools. Mm-hmm. We need to do that across the Commonwealth. Mm-hmm. So that's what I mean when I say it's all hands on deck. Mm-hmm. We need to think about every asset we have and how we're utilizing it to help educate ourselves, our next generation, the people trying to find jobs, up and down the line.
Okay, so now from education to public safety. Mm-hmm. Very interested where you come down on public safety and how we keep the citizens of the Commonwealth basically safe.
Yeah. So I think in Cambridge, we've had a very good community policing model where we actually are, we have police who are actually, their entire job is to work with the homeless population. Mm-hmm. So they know them by name. If someone goes missing, they realize it. We have police officers that are assigned a community beat. They know the people in the community. They're able to form trusting relationships. I think that's a model that we need to continue and could potentially be expanded across the Commonwealth. But yeah, I think that the days of community policing, I think, is what we need to go back to. You know, the idea that police officers are not just there to catch you and punish you, but to help maintain the heavies and that, and we've had our greatest successes when instead of taking somebody and just shooting them off jail, mm-hmm. has helped them connect to services and resources, because they're not a criminal. There's somebody in need of help, and I think that distinction is lost when you don't have community policing.
And so here's one of the big things that we face here at the Suffolk County Sheriff's Department. Because legislators are, for whatever reason, the money's been taken out of the budget for mental health and detox beds.
Yes.
Someone commits a crime in one of those areas, they go to jail.
Yeah.
And so 85% of our population is there because of some involvement with substances. 42% present with some form of mental illness.
Yep.
As Lieutenant Governor, how do you talk to legislators to say we need to get those dollars back into mental health beds, detox beds, or diversionary programs so the folks don't go to jail at all?
Well, I agree with you 100% that we need specialized courts, that we need to rethink our criminal justice system. And the way that, frankly, that we're going to get that done is going to be me bringing people like you in there, mm-hmm. who live it day to day, you understand, and bringing your people in there, mm-hmm. to make the case to the legislators. Because you're absolutely right. You know, we are treating, somebody comes in with a mental illness, and if you just send them off to jail, then all of a sudden that causes more problems in their life than they had to begin with.
Right.
I think that, that we have to end the pipeline to prison. I think that we need to have, we need mandatory minimums we need, mm-hmm. to do away with. I can go down the line. Mm-hmm. I think we agree on a lot of these things, but the way that we're gonna do this is, it's not gonna be just, I would love to, if I could just wave my hands and snap my fingers and make it happen, but it's gonna be me and you working in partnership to make it happen.
Finally, let me ask you this about casinos. Mm-hmm. What do you think about that? I mean, they came in, or the conversation came, well, the conversation's actually been going on for quite some time, but, they passed these bills that said we are going to have, I believe, 3 casinos and, mm-hmm. 1 slots parlor in the Commonwealth, and now we've kind of hit this point of, I don't know what you want to call it, where we just can't seem to get these things up and running, mm-hmm. and my understanding is that this actually may go back on the ballot.
Yeah.
There's a group that wants to repeal that.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on the casinos?
Well, my thoughts on the casinos are who knows what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. I mean, we're in front of the SJC right now, and then, mm-hmm. there's going to be a ballot initiative. We don't really know what's going to happen.
Do you think they should be in the Commonwealth?
So let me tell you my 3 concerns.
Please.
My 3 concerns are, A, first of all, as the only ethnic minority in a statewide campaign, mm-hmm. and as an Asian American who, historically, we have higher rates of gambling addiction than any minority, I'm very worried that the types of that casinos will prey upon those of us who have the least amount, mm-hmm. Least ability to afford going to them. Second thing that I'm concerned about, we've already, the introduction of casinos was predicated on the amount of revenue that we thought were going to bring to the state.
Right.
You've already heard that on NPR and on other in the news that other states are building casinos on our border to compete with the casinos they anticipate we're going to build.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think the revenue is going to materialize in the same way that we think it's going to materialize. Mm-hmm. Another third thing is that who owns the casinos that are up for bid right now? They're not owned in state.
Mm-hmm.
Wynn, Mohegan Sun, they're owned out of state.
Out of state.
So where are the profits going? Out of state. And if we want to, if the issue is that we need to invest, we need to have some big projects, mm-hmm. to create jobs, mm-hmm. to put our brothers and sisters in the unions back to work,
there's a lot of things we can build. Mm-hmm. We could update, we could modernize our schools. We could build more, we could fix our bridges. We could update some roads. Right. We could build some more incubator centers. We could build some more connections between the wind farms off the Cape to the advanced manufacturing in Springfield. There's a lot of things that we can build, that we can invest in, that will create the same kind of jobs, but I think will also create more revenue, create more, it will be more of an investment in ourselves mm-hmm. down the line as opposed to a tax on the poor. So I think that by the time I'm elected, if I'm elected to Lieutenant Governor, it may well be out of my hands, in which case I'll be working on trying to remedy, trying to make sure that the negative effects that casinos have been proven to bring to a population are addressed and are remedied. But who knows? I mean, it's in front of the courts now. Mm. I can't read their minds. It's going to be in front of the voters. I can't read their minds either. So
we'll see.
Right. Well, whatever the case is, we're going to deal with the situation.
Listen, I want to thank you for coming on today. We're out of time. We're going to follow the race clearly and love to have you back on as we get deeper into the dog days of summer so you can tell us just how it's going. But we wish you Godspeed.
Oh, well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for coming on. All right, folks, we're going to go to a break. And on the other side, we've got Steve Kerrigan, who's also running for the office of Lieutenant Governor. And he's going to be here to tell you why you should consider giving him your vote. Please do stay tuned.